Good afternoon, everyone. A warm welcome to all of you to this seminar titled Protect Your Financial Life with Some Key Facts on Safe and Smart Saving. We thank CRIF Highmark for supporting us to make this event possible. Before I start this introduction, let me invite on stage our speakers, Ms. Kalpana Pandey, CEO and MD of CRIF Highmark, Ms. Suchita Dalar, Founder Trustee of Money Life Foundation, and Mr. Debashish Basu, Founder Trustee of Money Life Foundation. May I request Mr. Abhay Datar to welcome Ms. Kalpana Pandey with a bouquet of flowers, please. Thank you, Mr. Datar. Let me start with a brief background about Money Life Foundation for those who are attending our program for the first time. Money Life Foundation was set up in 2010 to give a voice to savers and consumers of financial products and services. We have over 39,400 members nationwide and have conducted 280 workshops and seminars so far. In 2014, the foundation received the prestigious MRPI Memorial Award for its work in spreading financial literacy and consumer awareness. Membership to Money Life Foundation is free and simple. You only need to fill up the feedback forms that are available in the envelopes with you. We take pride in being fiercely independent and non-partisan. Our financial literacy programs do not hawk any product or services. We also run a free legal resource center, a tax helpline, and a credit helpline for those in financial distress. This year, we have launched daily free guidance clinics that are conducted by leading activists like Mr. Datta. These daily clinics are conducted from Monday to Friday between 5 to 7 p.m. at the Money Life Knowledge Center at Dadar. You can follow our all activities and workshops and come for personal guidance on range of issues, including public open spaces, waste management, RTI, public interest litigation, housing and real estate issues, filing consumer complaints and queries regarding insurance, banking and finance. We take your feedback seriously and organize talks based on members' request. So please don't forget to fill up the form in your envelope and hand it over to my colleagues before you leave. Do consider donating to Money Life Foundation to help us continue our efforts. Donations are eligible for ATG tax benefits. All our events are recorded and uploaded on Money Life Foundation website under events in case you want to check them out. Today's program flow is simple. We'll have a formal introduction of all three speakers and have the three talks consecutively. We'll then have an open house session to respond to your queries. Let me now introduce Ms. Suchita Dalal, who will speak on the mistakes that affect your financial life and how to keep your money safe from financial mistakes, Ponzi schemes, and email frauds. She is the founder trustee of Money Life Foundation and managing editor of Money Life. Ms. Dalal has over 30 years in journalism with some of India's leading newspapers, including the Times of India, Business Standard, the Economic Times, and Indian Express. She was awarded the Padma Shri in 2006 for her work and investigations, which include the Harshad Mehta scam of 1992 and coverage of other issues. She has been a member of the NR Narayan Murthy Committee on Corporate Governance, SEBI's Primary Market Advisory Committee, and the Investor Education and Protection Fund of the Ministry of Corporate Affairs. She was on Bank of Baroda's Customer Services Committee and the Consumer Complaints Committee of the Advertising Standards Council of India, ASCII. The next session will focus on smart investment to make your money grow safely. This will be conducted by Mr. Debashish Basu, who is the editor and publisher of Money Life magazine and also founder trustee of Money Life Foundation. Mr. Basu is a chartered accountant with 30 years of experience as a journalist. He has worked with most of India's leading publications such as the Times of India, Business World, Financial Express, Business India, Business Today, and he is a columnist of Business Standard and has written columns for the Economic Times as well. Mr. Basu was a member of the task force of SEBI on the creation of IndoNext market segment for smaller companies and has also served as a member of the Mutual Fund Advisory Committee of SEBI. He has co-authored several business books like The Scam, Path Breakers with Suchita Dalal, and is the author of Face Value, Growth Alchemy, and the Plain Truth series on stocks, mutual funds, and investments. The next session, Understanding Credit Information, Maintaining, Improving, and Rectifying Your Credit Report, would be conducted by Ms. Kalpana Pandey, who is the CEO and MD of CRIF Highmark. With over 23 years of experience in the BFSI segment, Ms. Pandey has been spearheading CRIF Highmark's transition into a new age credit information bureau in India. Earlier, she worked as Chief Technology Officer at Highmark and as Senior Vice President for IT at HDFC Bank. Ms. Pandey holds an M.Tech in Computer Science and Technology and PG Diploma in Electronics and Communication from IIT Roorkee. Her expertise in designing and managing many time and business critical setups in key organizations. She excels in conceptualizing and transforming challenges into business opportunities. Before I invite our first speaker, Ms. Dalal, on stage, may I request to switch off your mobile phone or put it on a silent mode? Please. Over to you, Suchita ma'am.
Good afternoon, everybody. This is going to be a brief session that I and Devashish will conduct, and the main focus today is, of course, the credit scores that most people are interested in. So I'm going to run through a small session on how to keep your money safe, and you would see why it is so important, because everything that we do, we earn, we learn, you know, all of it is for a job and a salary. And there are so many ways in which that just sort of vanishes like this because of simple mistakes that you can make. And the reason you make the mistakes is that you don't look at money the way you should. And at Money Life, we like to say that we just teach you how to look at money slightly differently from what you have known so far, which is not just to earn it, stash it in a bank and earn interest, but look a little beyond what happens when you're making savings decisions. Okay, so one of the first things we talk about is risk. I mean, human, despite so many hundreds of years of human evolution, in spite of years of human evolution, the human mind does not know how to grasp financial risk. This is not my discovery, it is a scientific discovery, and there is plenty out there on Google if you want to look at it. The reason that happens is that the human being knows how to understand fear. You see a tiger, the body reacts instinctively and you know that you have to run to save yourself. But if you see financial danger, no alarm bells go off in your mind to tell you what is wrong, what you should stay away from. And there are 100 other reasons why we make mistakes, because we don't look at financial products the way we ought to. One reason why we do this is that we look at financial products like consumer products. Okay, so you buy a toaster, you buy a microwave, you buy a fancy car, you essentially can start using it that day. You buy a toaster, you plug it in, it works. You buy a mixer, that's what happens. You buy a financial product, you have no idea whether you've made the right decision almost until a year later. The first time you get interest, dividend, or whatever is at least 1 year later, right? So there's no test drive for a mutual fund product. Even that fancy car will give you a test drive before you buy it. But any financial product, there is no concept of a test drive. You have to know before you invest. And most of us don't. So apart from the mistakes that you can make by not looking at a financial product differently, you also make the mistake of looking at brands. Every other product, if you buy whether it's a Nano or a Jaguar, there's a world of a difference. You pay a smaller price, you get smaller features, you have probably more risk about when, how long it will work. A bigger car is usually comes with a lot more features. Not so in the financial world. Okay, this is the only place where the brand only means a better ambience. The results can be as good or bad. Doesn't matter whether it is a small cooperative bank or a nidhi or a large one which has to be bailed out by the government, like you saw in the US in 2008. The biggest of global brand names needed a bailout. The third thing that happens with all products but work on our mind differently is that everybody is selling to you. So when you're getting an ad for a toaster or a mixer, it doesn't make a difference because you're actually seeing, you know, you're asking for a demonstration and buying. Financial products, the same sales pitch works differently. So you have the media pitching to you because they get ads. You have banks and distributors selling to you because they want customers. You even have all these heroes. So we keep saying that, you know, Sachin Tendulkar is God. So long as you're watching cricket, don't look to him for insurance advice. But he's out there telling you which insurance to buy, right? Same with Amitabh Bachchan. I'm a big fan, but I mean, I don't want him to tell security guys that it takes 2 minutes to decide an insurance. For God's sake, you cannot decide an insurance in 2 minutes or you're sure to lose money. And of course, the best of them, Irfan, I mean, the more brilliant the actor, the more convincing he is. And he convinced people that kam insurance lene ki bimari, so jada insurance lo. But you know, the chances of you getting your money, as we did some number crunching, go and look up Money Life, you got the least chances of getting your money back when you bought Jada insurance. So it doesn't work. Everybody is pitching to you. So what do you do? So for starters, let's look at a big scenario. If it seems too good to be true, it usually is. Okay. So if somebody comes running to you with a great investment opportunity, you have to sit down and tell yourself, how much will I get in a bank FD? You know that that is sort of the benchmark that, you know, you're going to get for safe investment. Anything that is 2-3% more than that should actually trigger an alarm, and you have to say, why is someone paying me more? And you have to start looking at money like that, not to get excited that I'm going to get, you know, a gift along with a corporate FD, or I'm going to get something else. But the minute somebody tells you, and this happens when you go to a bank, you go to a big bank and they'll tell you, why are you keeping your money in a bank FD these days? They'll say, go and put it somewhere else. And at least I do it. I ask them, why is your bank unsafe? Why do you not want me to put money in your bank and you're persuading me to put money outside? Answer is simple. They get higher commissions to take your business out of the bank and put it somewhere else. And if anything pays you a higher return, invariably there is a higher risk attached to it. It doesn't happen without a higher risk. So like I said, if it seems too good to be true, it usually is. So I'm now going to run you through a few ways in which the maximum number of people lose money. Okay, the world's biggest scam, believe it or not, people say nothing happens, we don't fall for the Nigerian scam. The Nigerian scam is a shorthand for what is called the advance fee scam, which means that anything, any email that comes to you which says you're winning a lottery, or RBI Governor Raghuram Rajan is going to give you money out of an escrow account, or some other African dictator's widow wants to send $25 million to you, it is all a hoax. And don't fall for it. If you look at a Money Life website on these scams where the RBI governor is supposed to be giving out money from an escrow account, you will see every single day there is a new comment saying, are you serious? Are you really saying I should not answer this? Yes, I'm really saying you should not answer this. Because all they want from you is advance fees. They'll tell you, money's coming to you. There's a small hitch. You need to pay a 200 rupee registration fee. You pay that, they know they've got you on the line. Okay, now they have to reel you in. So then it's a little more and it's a little more. How much do people lose? You would be surprised. We had someone who was a national level consumer activist, lost 35 lakhs. More than the 35 lakhs that he lost his reputation for life. He was known as the Ralph Nader of India, but he died unknown. Okay, very recently. Look at this guy. Any publicity is good publicity when you're in the film world. So he loses 7 lakhs with this foolishness, but he thinks it's still worth a story that his PR agency can plant. But it's just an example to show you that this is happening every day. Look at the papers differently and you will start seeing that I can spend the next 2 hours with pictures of very prominent, smart people who ought to have known better. Some of them are IAS officers and they're losing money to the advance fee scam. And this is not an Indian phenomenon, it's a global phenomenon, which is why I started by saying it is the biggest scam in the world. And it goes on because human greed exists. So this is one kind. The next kind is what we call Ponzi schemes. Okay, so you get money, somebody collects money and they give it out, your own money with absolutely high returns, so that you go running around waving a check saying, see, I've got the money, and you get your uncles and your brothers and your neighbors and you're putting it in. Because one of the conditions to these Ponzi schemes is that you have to get two or more people to come and invest in it. Okay, I'm sure each one of you knows double your money, you know, double your gold. There are different formats to it. This pyramid that I've put here is on the FBI website. It happens again, like I said, these very common scams are all over the world. The name Ponzi also comes from a man who ran this for so many years, earned billions of dollars, which is you're taking your own money and giving it back with a high return. Why this scam is more lethal is because it shows proof of you having got returns, which is why you're convinced. And people say, well, if I've got a return, it means it's safe. In fact, it's the opposite. It's the very nature of this scam that the early movers get a return. So what happens when you get a return? Okay, you're convinced, you're fully convinced that it's correct. So you do two things. One is you have got your entire family, neighbors and others involved in it. You may turn into a distributor. The second thing you will do is you will withdraw every other investment that you have and you will invest in this. Because who's going to be a fool enough to keep money at 8% in a bank FD when you're getting 30%, maybe 100%? Okay, people have even offered 100% returns. You take it out and put it in this. When those guys finally run away, you are completely a pauper because you've lost everything. And these can be this kind of thing where you're, you know, some right hand, some left hand, QNET, Speak Asia. I mean, there are any number of names. All of you have been hearing about it sometime or the other. People have been asking you to invest. So you would have heard about them. But they're not necessarily those kind either. They are even, this is a bunch of people who lost money in a company called City Limousine. Okay, I mean, look at how many people are in this room. But that crowd is 10,000 people sitting outside the police headquarters. Why? Because they gave this money to this man who sounded so reliable. He's even made movies like Chak De India. He was always seen in the papers with Shah Rukh Khan and Dilip Kumar. And today he's run away. Look at the number of people who should have known better who are investing over there, policemen and others. Usually when the guy gets caught, these influential people manage to get their money. Ordinary people are sitting in that crowd. Okay, and their money has not come back. He and his entire family is absconding. People are getting together as groups and spending more money in trying to recover their old money by going to court. And like I said, these are not the only ones. Sharda, 23 people have died. Nobody has got their money back in spite of Mamata Banerjee's promises. PACL, look at the breathtaking number, 49,100 crore this guy has collected over 25 years. And the reason I say this is that is how long a scam of this sort can go, because they're collecting money and giving it out. They don't need to earn anything. Most of this money has gone to countries like Australia. Again, really poor people have invested, and it's pretty tragic. QNET, I've already told you, lots of arrests. Even then, people are putting in money. I can keep running through it, but like I said, an example of how much. So maybe a Sharda will offer you 20% returns. Look at this woman here, okay? She's acted in a movie. She was offering a 200 to 400% return, and this is the tragedy. When I say think about money differently, it's only when it comes to financial investment, you are chasing the person who is promising high returns, saying mera check lo. Okay, you are not thinking. Otherwise, I don't see how people are giving her so much of money. She's of course spending time in jail these days as a guest of the state. Next kind of scam is all this phishing and wishing, which happens all over the internet. The minute you use emails, you are susceptible, because very genuine looking mails come to you saying that they're going to. I'm really glad that the police commissioner now is putting out a lot of ads and little videos to educate people, because they're all coming and telling you, we'll shut down your account if you don't give us your password. Some of them are calling you on the phone and they say, we are testing it out, and for God's sake, please do not give your one-time password. People actually give one-time passwords, and the guy is taking it from the phone, from, you know, on your mobile phone, from you, buying a doing a transaction, and before you know it, 30,000-40,000 rupees is gone out of your account, because it's as smooth and simple as that. They're calling you up and saying, we're checking your accounts and demanding your details, and you're giving it to them. Okay, so you're willing party to the scam because you know no better. Now, simple bottom line to this is, don't waste your time figuring out whether this is genuine or that is false, whether my account will be closed down. Believe me, no bank is going to make this call to say, we're checking out your accounts. Anytime you're dealing with a bank, it should not be on the phone that you receive or an email that you get from them. However good it looks, it can be cloned to look like a genuine site. You have to tell them, put down the phone, I'm going to call, not your number back. Okay, people have lost money like that. I'm going to pull out my account statement, look at the call center number, call the official call center and find out. So suppose someone says, in 15 minutes your account is going to be blocked if you don't do XYZ. Don't panic. You pull out your call center number officially of your bank. If you have a relationship manager, call them and ask. And 100%, I'm not even saying 99.9, 100% it is going to be false, so you don't have to fall for it. Now, why am I spending so much time on this? Because to those who know, it sounds like so obvious, How can anyone fall for it? But just open the Times of India every day or Mumbai Mirror. Every single day or every alternate day, you will have a story like this, including the Chief Minister's PA who lost money recently. Because he was the Chief Minister's PA, it sort of got resolved in 2 days' time. Doesn't happen for you and me. Okay? It's going, our money is gone forever because we don't have that kind of clout. But this is the rate at which people are getting fooled. So where do we put our money? We usually put it in banks, right? Standard, banks are safe, that's where we do it. So let's look at what happens with banks. According to me, we are lucky in India. Most of our banking system, at least 42%, I know that all of you all are reading about huge NPAs and bad loans and all that. I still say nothing to worry about because 45% of the banking system is Sarkari. So those who are making losses, Government of India, there's an implicit sovereign guarantee. So at least your fixed deposits are safe, right? Now, bank FDs, lots of people will tell you only 1 lakh is insured. It's true. As long as you're in a nationalized bank again, that doesn't have to worry you. Large private banks also, not a worry at all. And when I say large, it's a really big definition because Global Trust Bank wasn't very large, okay, when the Ketan Parikh scam happened. But the Indian government decided even that will not be allowed to fail. So it was a forced merger that happened and it was taken over. So many of India's loss-making banks, private sector, not very big, get merged. Sometimes a forced merger by the RBI, sometimes a voluntary merger. But by and large, if it's a large bank, it is safe. Even if only 1 lakh of it is insured, as long as I'm talking large banks, it doesn't matter. You look at the 30-year record and you will see no money has ever been paid out from the Deposit Insurance Guarantee Fund for any large bank. On the other hand, cooperative banks fail with regularity. And everybody here will tell you, especially senior citizens, that but I get 1% more, not worth the risk, okay? Because just too many of them, on an average we have found about one cooperative bank fails every month. And RBI declares a failure about 2 to 3 years after the bank has virtually gone bankrupt because they don't act on it. There is dual governance. It is under the Registrar of Cooperatives as well as RBI, which means neither of them regulated properly. And 2 years after there is a moratorium, there is, you know, money is not coming out, then they finally put it in liquidation, after which you get your measly 1 lakh back. So I would say if it is your hard-earned money, not worth the risk of that 1% or 2% extra, and definitely not worth saying that I will buy shares of the cooperative bank also, then it's safer. No, you lose both because you lose your equity first and then your at least fixed deposits 1 lakh is safe, right? So while banks in India are very safe, this is something that you need to worry about. Now, while banks are safe, as I said earlier, banks themselves are encouraging you not to put money in the bank and saying put it somewhere else. That becomes unsafe. Okay? So, in fact, there was a joke, a cartoon recently of this man walking into a bank. He's, you know, carrying a gun and he's got a bag and he walks in saying, "Hands up. If anybody tells me to buy an insurance or any other product, I'm going to shoot. I've come here to deposit my money and I don't want anyone selling me anything else." This is how bad the Indian banking system has become, where you go to a bank, they want you to buy something else. They are hard selling insurance. They're trying to persuade you to take out money from your FDs and put it elsewhere. That is something you have to worry about. And who does the maximum of that hard selling? It's your relationship manager, which is a concept which is like about 10, 15, 20 years old. All of us were very thrilled to have relationship managers. But remember, the relationship manager's job is to manage one relationship and one relationship alone, which is to get you to take out that money and put it in investments where the bank earns the highest return. It could be a mutual fund, it could be a unit-linked insurance plan. It is not your interest that they're looking at, but they're looking at the bank's profitability. Let's be very clear about it. This is how the system works. We may not like it, but that's the new reality. So what is the other place where we put our money? Okay, we're not talking trading, speculation, because most of what we do at Money Life is looking at safe investments that we, the ordinary people, do. So fixed deposits is a big one, right? And here again, you need to look at money differently. For several years, my parents and others used to put money in corporate FDs, spend a lot of time looking at which big company is now offering FDs. All that has more or less changed in 1991. When we embarked on economic liberalization, the world began to change. Today, a good company has lenders chasing it to offer it money. Okay? So a good company gets the lowest interest, lowest loan rate, usually from the banking system. They can raise it at even lower prices abroad. So the largest of Indian companies are even raising money abroad, and they don't need to come to you for a fixed deposit. Second, they do not need to pay you more interest than they would pay to a bank. But still, even today, most of us are still looking for, we don't change our mindset, because the agent comes to your house or he has a share shop around the corner, he's offering you investment opportunities. Again, what do you fall for? That 1% or 2% more. And it's pretty tragic, I can tell you, because the amount, I mean, the callousness of government to the plight of people who have lost money in FDs is unbelievable. After 3 years of persuasion by people who have lost money, and the reason why we weren't taking up this issue is because we tell people don't put money in corporate FDs, right? So we said, when we are so clear that we tell you not to put money in corporate FDs, why should we take it up? But at the request of many, many, many senior citizens, we finally did a survey. We sent a memorandum with 1,596 complaints with names, phone numbers, details to the Ministry of Corporate Affairs. We did not even get an acknowledgement. This is in spite of us being an NGO. We then followed it up with an RTI. After we filed an RTI, the first part of the memorandum was the six companies with the highest number of complaints. So those six companies, they have said, we are asking the regional ROCs to take a look at it. And one of them, Helios and Matheson, they said Serious Frauds Office will look. What does that really mean? Absolutely nothing. Okay, because we pushed them, we got some answers. But where the investor is concerned, it still means a big zero, because there's no sign of anybody getting any money. And among the two biggest over there with the highest number of complaints is Jayaprakash Associates, which, as you know, the banking industry is struggling about whether to declare them an NPA or not. And there is Unitech, where every single day there are people in a worse situation than the FD guys, people who have booked flats and paid crores of rupees, who are having to drag them to court. So FD people are last in the queue. It's unsecured money, and you are going to have it very difficult to get your money back. So corporate FDs, according to us, is a no-no. And don't bother to say whether this company is good or that company is good. We feel today the best companies are able to raise money elsewhere. They do not need corporate FDs. Right? I'm just going to run through credit cards. Do you need a credit card? Today, yes, even if you want to book an Uber, you need a credit card, okay, or you can do Paytm. But you get stranded somewhere, you need it. You need to know, this is one of the most, it's, somebody said, one of the Dilbert comics called it crack cocaine of the financial world. Because the whole system works on the fact that you are spending money that you don't have, and you are not paying back 100%. If you have a credit card and you pay back 100%, it's perfect. It's a very good tool. But credit card companies don't like you if you do that, okay? Because they don't earn any money on you. Zero. In fact, even the plastic that they give you is a cost to them. It's when you don't pay that they really love you. And this is what happens then. The interest rate is 40 to 65% depending on which card that you have. The bigger the brand, bigger the interest that they charge you. If you roll over, no free credit period, it all keeps getting added. And this is something people don't realize. They've not paid back 100%. They're spending again on their card, and they think they still have a 40-day, 60-day, whatever it is, a free period. No, there's no free period if you have an outstanding. That gets added on, and the high interest starts immediately. Cash withdrawal. Somebody says, take a I got a mailer yesterday saying, take a personal loan on your credit card. It's the most daft thing you can do, because you are then buying at, you know, taking a personal loan at this incredible interest rate. And on part payment, if you've got a cash loan that you've taken, it gets adjusted last. Now I'm coming to one more section where Indians have, it's been drilled into our mind about how you can lose money efficiently. Okay. So all of you have seen this ad. कान खींच कर ये समझाए सुनो बेटा बुद्धू राम जब घर में पड़ा है सोना
तब का है कोरोना, भोले ना पैसा रख के सोना, दो मिनट में काम है होना।
So look at how honest it is. The guy's name is Buddhu Ram. Okay? And only a Buddhu Ram is going to go and put his gold and get money. Why are people doing it all the time? Because it's 2 minutes. They say it's like, you know, getting money from a cash teller. And you look at it, every time people are in difficulty, anyone who understands money, we were listening to a presentation by Vijay Kedia last week. He's a fantastic investor who's made crores of rupees. And he was talking about the mistakes he's made in his life. At one stage, apparently, got into so much of trouble in the stock market that his mother offered to sell her gold. Now, this is the difference. Family that understands money will say, I will sell my gold to pay back my son's speculative losses. They will not say, I will take a gold loan. Because a gold loan is the most daft thing that you do. It's your capital. You own the gold. You're going and pledging it. And you're paying an interest on your money. Why? Because you claim to have such emotional attachment to that particular, you know, gold bangle or whatever earrings that you have, as though you've inherited it after from 10 generations of some kind of princely antique value that it has. So you don't want to sell that particular piece. It is the most ridiculous thing, and I'm going to quickly run through why. Because A, they charge you 15 to 25% as interest. We ask people, who gets 15%? Nobody. So it's essentially about 2%, 24% interest per annum on your own gold. That too, not the full gold. You get, there's a 30% haircut because they want to keep the risk of gold prices going up and down. So if you want, if you pledge 1 lakh worth of gold, you get only 70,000 back because they're keeping that 30%. In addition, they're charging you processing charges. Okay? And believe me, this level of payment, which is 24% interest plus costs, is almost impossible. If you had that ability to repay, you're most probably not going to be in a position where you need to pledge the gold at all. So our thing is, which we have written last week in Money Life, please sell the gold. Okay? So whatever you would have paid as interest, if you pay buy back that much of gold, maybe a gram or two, you're going to be much smarter. And look at the numbers. Right, so we are talking about a 1 lakh gold, so 70% of market value. If you sell it, first of all, you get the full value. So 50 grams of gold is what we have taken in this example. You can actually, if you want the same 1 lakh, it's 1.4 lakh is the value. To get 1 lakh, you're going to pledge 50 grams. You don't even have to pledge. If you're selling, you can sell only 70% of it. So what is the return? You're saying 2,000 rupees per month if you're going to return at 2%, you add another 500 and you buy back that much of gold so that it includes your cost of replacement. You look at it, you will be able to buy it back in 39 months. While if you're going to pay interest, and I don't know who earns that kind of money, it's going to take you 82 months. This is a diagram of how much that is the value and that is the interest that you're paying. Your interest is more than the value of the gold. So anytime you're in financial difficulty, for God's sake, please sell gold which you have and start buying it back. Do not ever take a loan against gold. But the companies which give loan against gold and banks are hugely profitable because, you know, it's so easy to take people for a ride. And when we wrote this the first time and when I tweeted it, I was quite astonished at how many people had just not done this thinking and these numbers, and they said, we never thought about it. Because the first thought that comes is you're getting those ads drilled into your mind. So the first thought that comes to you these days is, in 2 minutes, you're going to pledge the gold and get your money. It's a wrong thing to do. I'm going to quickly end with small things. 5 most dangerous words. Tell me where to sign. This happens whether it's your DMAT account, whether it's your insurance policy that you're opening. Without looking at details, we are ready to sign when it comes to financial instruments because our mind closes when we see numbers. So we say, okay, aap sab kar lo, I trust you. I won't trust you with a bowl of sugar. But when it comes to 1 lakh rupees, I trust you because it's too much trouble for me to understand. Second, insurance. I'm not going to spend time on this because it's an extremely complex subject. I just want to say that here it's almost like the opposite of a loan that you take. It's buyer beware versus utmost good faith. When you're buying any other financial product, they say buyer beware, caveat emptor. When you're buying insurance, the insurance company is taking you on good faith. They are telling you to fill up a form, collecting your premium. Only when they have to pay you back, do they need to put your form under a magnifying glass and check, did you declare things? Is your date of birth right? Did you get your address right? Did you not reveal that you had hypertension? Did you not reveal that you had diabetes? Because that is the time they're going to take a decision on whether to make the payment to you or not. So when you have insurance, don't say, "Hi, I have an insurance policy." Do you have the right one? Have you got it correctly? Have you got all your facts filled in? Did you look at what you did? Because there's no point in paying a premium on insurance if there are mistakes, because when you go to make a claim, you're not going to get it. Finally, basic financial hygiene. Remember, try and make a will, because it's complex. Most of us are now earning our own money. We're not inheriting. Each one has a house. You must make those decisions while you're capable of making them. More important, ensure that you have nominations filled in on all your financial products, because that's a way of planning that people have. And people can make huge mistakes. This is a young guy who died. This is a true story, and we keep putting pictures to tell you that this is not fairy tales. This is happening in real life with people. He had got divorced, hadn't removed his ex-wife's name from his account. He dies. He leaves an old mother who then has to go to court to battle an ex-wife who's married again because he forgot to change his nomination, if you please. Okay, so his savings bank account had 1.44 crore and his poor old mother was fighting in court, and finally it's almost on humanitarian grounds that the judge said the ex-wife doesn't deserve it, this will go to the mother, in spite of documents being not okay, because otherwise that woman had a right, she was the nominee. Okay, so financial hygiene is really important. You have to do an annual check. We say, A, avoid losses. That's the burden of my session. Second, make a plan. Third, wills, nomination, insurance. These are part of, you know, planning. Make sure that you do it. Finally, when I say when in doubt, remember MoneyLife, because we run a whole lot of free advisory services, free counseling, free legal resource center, free tax helpline. It's all free. And there are people who go to organizations which are called debt doctors and what have you, where they charge you 20 to 25,000 for the same bit of advice, and you're paying it because you're waiting until you're desperate, you're in a panic, you've made a mistake, and then you're paying somebody to resolve it without again worrying about whether they can or they can't. Thank you.